His name, people knew him as Wamalwa Kijana. But his real name was Michael Christopher Simiyu. Michael Christopher. Catholics do have two Christian names. So he was Michael Christopher. His name was Simiyu because he was born during drought season. His father was William Wamalwa. William Wamalwa. He was the first senator for Trans Nzoia. Or if you have to speak it in vernacular, Trans Nzoia. So he, when in the mid 60s, the Senate was merged with the National Assembly, Jomo Kenyatta employed William Wamalwa as a permanent secretary. When Senator Wamalwa, William Wamalwa died, his eldest son, Michael Christopher Simiyu, decided not to get married, but to make sure that all his siblings and step-siblings were educated to the university level. He was a lecturer at Nairobi University lecturing law. He came up with a paper on marine law. That paper is quoted international wide. But you'll find that some lawyers like him are, we have very many different types of lawyers. Like him, he was more of an academician. We have others who are employed by companies as company secretary, others are whatever. And others are even called conveyance lawyers, whose work is only to make sure when you're buying or selling property, he sells. It is only these who appear in court, especially who appear in court on matters of criminal cases that are known. But coincidentally, they are very poor as compared to the other lawyers. So that is Wamalwa Kijana. Wamalwa Kijana, I'm related to him. Just like I'm related to very many people. William Wamalwa and Kina Eugene, all of them are from the Vaengere clan. And my paternal grandmother was from the Vaengere clan. Now, when Bukusus go for initiations, they go around homes. They go around homes. This year, they go to so-and-so's home. The other time, they go to so-and-so's home. Like me, Omuchuma Osimika number 72, we went to a place, to a mzee's home called Lukhale. So, when Michael Christopher Simiyu was being initiated, he initiated in the home of Werunga, Werunga Wambuya. Werunga Wambuya, the same home that my father was initiated much, much earlier. Simiyu is a Munyange, Munyange age group, and my father was Kinyikeu. So the very same home of Werunga Wambuya that my father passed through is where Wamalwa Kijana passed through. My father was adopted as a Mwengere boy because in Bukusu tradition, the last born is allowed to follow the traditions of his mother. So by extension, I'm Mwengere, although I am a Musamo, and my father was a Musamo. Wamalwa Kijana, as I said, he decided not to marry, but educate his siblings. When his father died in the late 60s, Wamalwa Kijana decided later to contest. There used to be two constituencies. It was Kitale East and Kitale West. So he contested against Wafula Wabuge. He contested against Wafula Wabuge. And Wafula Wabuge originally is from Lwandeti. It's originally from Lwandeti. Lwandeti, the home of Luandeti is a home of Werangai. Burundi na Bwera doesn't come far from far, and so on and so on. But Wafula Buke migrated to Kitale and they contested. In that election, you see, these are people from one village. They have all moved to another village in a transfer, in a settlement scheme. By then, Wamalwa Kijana was a pilot. He hired a plane, and since he's so much traveled, he wherever he went and learned how to. He was a pilot, so he hired a plane at Wilson Airport, and when he went for campaigning, he used to drop through the window his pamphlets. He was using a system that was yet to come. And Wafula Buke used to say, that huyu ni kijana ya Wamalwa. You see, William Wamalwa was hated. He was a dictator or something. So he used two systems to win that election. He was telling people that this is, remember Wamalwa, Senator Wamalwa, this is hii kijana yake. And then Michael Christopher Simi would tell people, mimi ni kijana tu ya Wamalwa. You see, he was using the technology that today is there. Today you cannot be convicted for your father's of wrongs, eh? But those days you could. So when he confirmed that, yeah, mimi ni kijana ya Wamalwa, that is how the name Wamalwa Kijana stuck. Another thing that Wafula Buke used, he used to tell people that, you see, me, I'm on the ground talking to people, walking. But him, he's up there with the egos, giving them pamphlets. So we people on the ground just campaign vote for the person on the ground and let the ego and other birds vote for the aeroplane. You see, in English, in Swahili, aeroplane and bird are the same thing, ndege. So he lost that. He also came, he became so close to Masinde Muliro, Henry Pius Masinde Muliro, who mentored him, and he even won the elections in the same constituency later. But as Masinde Muliro was having problem, so was Michael Christopher Wamalwa Kijana. Come to multi-party. We came to have this multi-party on the issues of party affiliation. Obviously, he affiliated himself to Henry Pius Masinde Muliro. Then it happened that Masinde Muliro died, and Ford Kenya wanted to appreciate the Bukusus. So they decided that the position, because Henry Pius Masinde Muliro was the first vice chairman and Paul Mwite was the second vice chairman. So they saw that there was no need of Michael Christopher Simiyu jumping Paul Mwite. So he was made the second vice chairman, and Mwite was made the first vice chairman. It was not easy, because that position was given to Bukusus, and it was felt that two lawyers were very close to Masinde Muliro. There was Michael Christopher Simiyu and George Captain. So there was even a lot of problems between them, but the coin fell on Michael Christopher Simiyu, who became the second vice chairman. When he became the second vice chairman, then there was a time when Goldenberg fellow Patney approached, went to Ajip House and told Jaramogi Oginga Odinga that he wanted. He told Jaramogi Oginga Odinga that he wanted to give something to the to the party, some money. So he was allowed. When he was allowed, he gave out a briefcase, which he claimed and still claims that it had 20 million shillings. And he said it had 20 million shillings. Jaramogi Oginga Odinga told Paul Mwite, who was also the party lawyer, he told him that you can go and bank the money. So Paul Mwite took 2 million to Ford offices and 18. Nobody knows where it went. So Jaramogi went around and saying that if he were to get, the first thing he would do if he was the president, he would jail Patni. When he said he would jail Patni, one day he was watching the TV, and then he was shown this is Patni. Patni appeared on the news item. Then he called his people and said, is Patni not the person who gave us money the other day? He said, yes, he's the one who gave out the money the other day. Then he said, there's no need of having the money, because when we take over power, we will be compromised. So he called a press conference and apologized and said, Kamlesh Patni would be given his refund. So he told, he ordered Paul Mwite to surrender the money to Patni. Paul Mwite surrendered 2 million, because 2 million is what 18 was not accounted for. So when 18 could not be, Patni said, it's okay, if you want to return my money, it's okay. But it was not 2 million, it was 20 million. Because of that shame and so on and so forth, Paul Mwite had to move from Ford Kenya and join or even form Safina Party. Safina Party, which was there to save Kenyans the way the Noah's Ark saved people during those biblical days. Now, when Paul Mwite went, Michael Christopher Simiyu became the first vice chairman. Now, you can see a very patient person who was just, they used to be called Young Turks. Yeah, this side they used to be called Young Turks, and the other side they used to be called YK92. He was a loyal Young Turk. He went up the steps, and then he became the first vice chairman. When he became first vice chairman, February 94, Jaramogi went to be with the Lord. Jaramogi went to be the Lord. And obviously, this number two in the political party was supposed to be now the head. But Raila could not agree. He used to say that he could not agree his father's party to be taken. So it went on that way. There was that physical and legal fights. You remember, Akikuyu Archbishop Kuria is the one who tried to unite them, but it became a bit tough for them to be joined together. So they could not join together. And that is and you see, when Jaramogi died, KANU and Ford Kenya were the only parties with MPs from all over Kenya. Ford Kenya had Professor Muzee in Coast, and it had also this, what is the name of this lawyer who is in Wiper now? Farah Malim from Northeastern, from Garissa. So Northeastern, they were there, Coast, they were there, they were everywhere. But when the elections were going to be held, because he died in 1994, when elections were in 1996, Raila sabotaged Wamalwa Kijana. When he sabotaged Wamalwa Kijana, he went away with the Luo Nyanza MPs. And so Wamalwa Kijana moved from being the official leader of opposition to just one of the leaders in the opposition. And that is how Mwai Kibaki overtook him, and Mwai Kibaki became the official leader of opposition. When Mwai Kibaki became the official leader of the opposition, then 1997, that is 1 year after Raila left, Ford Foundation, yes, the very same Ford Foundation that Ruto was alleging that they were financing Gen Z, came up with a formula where they were to finance the official opposition leader, the official opposition leader to take over. Now, when they planned this thing, Michael Christopher Simiyu was the official leader of opposition. So when it came to implementation, Kibaki was the official leader of the opposition. But Kibaki saw that there was he could not win this thing alone. He needed to rope in others. That is when he roped in Ngilu, and he roped in Wamalwa Kijana. They used to go to Norfolk Hotel for meetings and so on. They used to go to Norfolk Hotel for meetings and planning and whatever. And you see, Daniel Arap Moi had promised everybody in KANU. He was promising everybody, I'll make you the KANU candidate, including Raila. So that one, Raila, knowing that he had been promised by Moi that he would be handed over the mantle, he started attacking them. He was saying, you see, there are some things like Wamalwa Kijana, Kibaki, and Ngilu meeting in Norfolk Hotel, and then you go to a meeting in a place Oshago, you say, ni nini hii wanaume wawili na mwanamke wa mmoja mnafanya kwa loji? You see, that is exact words that Raila used to use. Then it went on. One day at Kencom House, a prominent Luo was sent by Moi, where Moi suggested that he wanted Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta to be the presidential candidate for KANU and Raila Amolo Odinga to be the running mate. But Raila sent that person and said, my father was his father's deputy. Do you want to say that I also become his deputy, so that it becomes we are the fellow? Said that apparently that is what I nearly said Jomo Kenyatta. That is why Daniel Arap Moi wants. Then Raila said it can't happen. And that is when he now moved out of KANU. He approached the three he was saying that mnakunywa chai, no, wanaume wawili na mwanamke mmoja kwa loji. He turned to them and said he wants to join them. They said they were welcoming him. There was no problem with him joining them and his team. And then he told Mwai Kibaki that NAC, which is NAC, would offer the presidency, and the LDP would offer the vice president. If you read between the line, he was trying to say that Kibaki becomes the president and Raila becomes the vice president. And Kibaki told him that if you so wish, you come as the third force. Let Uhuru be there. Let us be this side, and let Uhuru and his team on the other side. That is the time when, you know, women are easier in compromising things. And the agreement had been that Wamalwa Kijana would be the vice president and Ngilu would be the prime minister. So Ngilu is the one who offered Raila the position of prime minister. While Raila was not contented with that, he went and crafted up an MOU. The MOU was essentially meant, that the president and the vice president, after being elected, just like in France, Paris, they would hand over the powers to the party with the majority. And the party with the majority, that is NAC, would appoint Raila as the executive president, prime minister, and the two would just be ceremonial. But then, never trust a politician, especially a politician who looks simple like Mwai Kibaki. So Mwai Kibaki accepted. And this thing happened also another time, several years later. It happened several years later when Jimmy Wanjigi crafted a winning team, and he just told them, for what I want, I just want the SGR from Mombasa to Nairobi. So these things are, you agree with somebody, but once he's sworn in, he becomes somebody else. So that is what happened. And when Raila did not get what he wanted, that is how the things went and went. Now we are talking about Wamalwa Kijana. Wamalwa Kijana had a chemistry with Mwai Kibaki, and I can say without any fear of contradiction that if there is any deputy president who has ever felt comfortable in ruling, it is Wamalwa Kijana. It's coming a poor second is the current president, Ruto. Ruto, during the first Uhuruto, he became almost like a co-president. Now, if you compare the deputyship of Ruto and the deputyship of Wamalwa, is that Ruto pushed himself to power and he used to execute powers. You see, Uhuru was a ceremonial type of president. He liked that. And also so was Mwai Kibaki. But the chemistry between Mwai Kibaki and Wamalwa Kijana was genuine, was a genuine love. But the kind of association between Uhuru and Ruto was like Lady Diane and King Charles. They were just, a research was done and it was found that the best person to be a future queen was Princess Diana. So you see, there is the marriage of convenience and the marriage of love. Nani had all the powers. Actually, that is the time when they even came up with an idea that the vice president should not have a ministry to run. And Wamalwa Kijana was comfortable with that. But Kangumu rushed and informed the Bukusus and all Luyas that a vice president without a ministry is a powerless person. And that is why Wamalwa was given a ministry, because Kibaki avoided that. It is unfortunate that during that time, both people were sick. Of course, Wamalwa was sick with HIV, and Kibaki with the accident and old age. So that is how it happened. And when both of them were in the hospital, one of them had to come out. And if Mwai Kibaki would not have had the accident, Kibaki would run the government. Kibaki would run the government, and Wamalwa would be on he would be on those drugs. But since both of them were sick, and Wamalwa being young and whatever, that is what happened. Now, as we finish the story of Wamalwa Kijana, Wamalwa Kijana was staying in a rental house, and he was staying in a rental house where he fell back on rent. So when he became the vice president, the REC company, you see, the former vice presidents were ministers of home affairs, so they were being guarded by Kenya Prison. And then the vice president, even the deputy president today, has no portfolio. So that is why there is the issue of security. And you can remember a REC company being removed from Karen, being replaced by CIPU, Critical and Infrastructure Protection Unit of the AP. So you find that Wamalwa had no ministry. He was being guarded by GSU, the GSU. So the landlord was coming to collect rent, and the GSU would stop him from. So they told him, he went to the press and said, assist me to evict that fellow because he's not paying rent and I can't get him and whatever. That is the genesis of building current house, because it was decided there and then that Wamalwa Kijana get a house. And then the question was, you know, state houses are gazetted houses. Now, if each and every vice president, because Moi was given the Kibera house, which was meant for vice presidents. Now, if every vice president who is there, and the turnout for vice president is more than the president, if every vice president has to be built a house, then it was decided that they build one house, which would be, they build just one house, which would be for each and every coming vice president. And why was it chosen that it be in Karen, in a military camp? You see, in America, we follow the American system. The president stays at White House, and the vice president stays at Pentagon, the military place. So one of the military places in Kenya had to be found. As for Wamalwa Kijana, they constructed the house, but it was completed when he is dead. Now he's dead, his children are adults. I have to also to tell you the truth about what is happening in that land. Some malicious people are saying that my cousin Eugene is trying to snatch that. No. What has happened is this. Wamalwa Kijana had several kids. Jabali, the one who is foreign-based, said he does not want anything from his father. The others have to share things. And there is no problem about sharing things. Now, it comes to the house. So Eugene is suggesting that he buys the house, and after buying the house, then the money is shared to all those. And I see a lot of reason there, because even where I'm staying, the plots are for siblings. You find that staying together siblings is not okay. Why don't you people just get money? Because that plot there is very expensive before you start counting the houses and whatever. Those houses are... That house is very expensive, and they can each one even buy plots in the same area and build their own smaller houses, because that is like a state house. So when it is sold, and they are given money, they can each one of them can even buy their own plots there and construct. Mwana wa papa, lidoba silikona angenjala ta, menyabula iwa were fwe kusiri baalamu.